Hello and good afternoon, everyone. He did it his way, Bud Grant. You just heard in his own words, a celebration of the remarkable life and times of Bud Grant. Throughout the afternoon, we'll be hearing from people whose lives were touched and impacted by Bud in so many ways, as well as from Bud himself throughout the years. We'll hear from son Mike Grant on behalf of the Grant family. Vikings head coach Kevin O'Connell is here, along with Senator Amy Klobuchar, to honor Bud. Friends of Bud are here as well to talk about him off the field, including Paul Wigan and Ron Shearup. We'll get some stories, a lot of them, I'm sure, about covering Bud in the media, from Patrick Ricey and Mike Max, Dan Barrero, and Chad Hartman, of course, who has quite an association with his dad, Sid, and Bud. Plus, we'll hear from some of Bud's players who fondly recall playing for him, including Carl Eller, Chuck Foreman, Stu Voigt, and Scott Studwell. A reminder in your program and on the sides of the video board, we'll be displaying a QR code for two charities near and dear to Bud. We encourage you to support them in his honor. One is Minnesota Veterans Outdoors, a partnership of veteran service organizations and other community partners who come together to offer outdoor programs and activities for veterans. The other code is for Minnesota Vikings Foundation, a public charity organization that advances the well-being of youth through engaging health and education initiatives. Well, I think we all know how important the national anthem was to Bud, considering his military service, love of the country. And we thought to kick things off, we'd hear from Bud about that tradition. I think he may have been the only coach in the history of the NFL who practiced having his players stand it for the national anthem. And we'll hear from Bud about which was so near and dear to him.
I was indoctrinated to be an American. I was proud of that. The national anthem was very important to me. The least we can do is give respect to the flag and stand at attention. We'll line up, we'll all stand the same way, put our feet in the same direction, hold your helmet the same way, no chewing gum, scratching your behind. I put Carl Eller, Jim Marshall, and Mick Tinkelhoff. You guys are in charge. They used to call it the Viking formation. That was good.
Please rise and place your right hand over your heart. Today's color is presented by the Minnesota National Guard. We honor America with the performance of our national anthem by Minnesota native and veteran of the United States Navy, John D. Causemaker. John?
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars perilous fight o'er the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the right regular, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the brave?
For Bud Grant, life went on.
You've got six children, you come from absolute zero, your main commitment in life is to take care of your family and to provide them possibly with the things that you didn't have. And you get satisfaction. I get more satisfaction out of providing for my family than I ever did coaching a football game.
It was this healthy life perspective that endeared Bud Grant to the men who played for him.
Because he didn't sleep in the locker room. He didn't watch film endlessly. He went out and hunted on Saturday before the game. He never yelled. He never screamed. He never berated. But he was a great, great leader and a great, great coach. And I was privileged to play for him. If you could not play for Bud Grant, you could not play.
And now to represent the Grant family, I'm proud to introduce his son, a legend in his own right, Mike Grant.
I was commenting to some of my family members just now. It reminds me of our Hall of Fame day when my dad went into Canton, and we were all gathered there sitting like this as we listened to my dad's speech. First of all, the Grant family, we want to thank you all for coming today. My dad would have wondered why you were here on a beautiful day in the spring. He would have said, why aren't you at the cabin? Or why aren't you doing something outdoors? My dad had an awesome life. I hope today when you leave that that we're not feeling sad or remorseful, but I hope you're smiling and have fond memories of all the things people are going to talk about today. My family, like all families, have had some heartaches, losing my mom to Parkinson's, losing brother Bruce to glioblastoma, and now my dad. But we are no different than any other Minnesota family. We all go through these things. We just happen to have a father and grandfather and great-grandfather who was and is the most recognizable sports figure in Minnesota sports. My sisters Kathy and Lori and brothers Pete and Dan want to thank you for all your support and your love for our dad. We fully realize we shared our dad with the people of the upper Midwest. He loved his country, he loved the people of Minnesota and the states that surround us. It started with his love of Superior, Wisconsin. His parents, Harry Sr. and Bernice, raised three boys, Harry Jr., Buddy Boy, Bud, that's as his name became, Jack and Jim. He was raised in the Depression. He was a boy of the Depression, where one of his favorite activities was going to the town dump with his father and shoot the scurrying rats with his .22. That was a highlight for him. Or maybe on Saturday mornings, he'd tell the story that on Saturday mornings, he would go down to the hardware store where all week he had been staring at the wood baseball bats in the barrel, and on Saturday morning, the owner would allow him to hold on to one of the bats. That was a highlight for him. Maybe grabbing a chunk of ice that fell from the ice truck that delivered the ice for the refrigerator, and he said the joy of having a big chunk fall on the ground that you could take and then eat. That was the Depression, and that's where he grew up. He learned to throw accurately and become a great pitcher by throwing rocks at telephone poles. It was indeed really a simple life. We want to thank all these people of the upper Midwest. He spent time in almost every region of the state and the upper Midwest. His travels would take him towards Owatonna and his good friend Buzz Kaplan. They became great friends and then decided to travel from the tip of South America to the Arctic Circle. They once spent 2 days in a little tiny helicopter on a small island no bigger than this, sitting there waiting for the weather to change. He loved to travel to the North Country around International Falls and hunt and fish with the great state senator Bob Lassard. Bob's stories of their trips together are infamous. starting with the time they drove to Nebraska, and my dad made a comment that Bob talked too much, and then neither one spoke to each other all the way to Nebraska. Both were stubborn men. My dad spent his last hunting trip last fall in Otter Tail County near Henning, Minnesota. I finally remember him hunting deer last year and having breakfast at the old Homestead Cafe, where he was as comfortable as if he was at some fancy restaurant. He chatted with many of the locals as if he was an old friend. And I think in many ways, to all of you, he really was an old friend. He loved to sneak away from practice at the old Met Stadium, just not even a mile away, with his good friend Norm Berg, and hunt the river bottoms where the Mall of America is now. Norm was a great friend and confidant. My dad spent, and he might say, way too many days in Mankato, when the days when there were six exhibition games and you spent 6 weeks in Gage Hall. But he did enjoy driving 169 down to Mankato because he was always looking for deals, things on the side of the road, which most likely were sold later at his garage sales. I want to this time say, if you bought an old weed trimmer or a trolling motor that never worked, know that that put a smile on my dad's face as you walked down the driveway and he had gotten rid of some useless piece of equipment. He also loved playing town team baseball all over the state, from Hastings to Osceola, under his dear friend Lute Pettis, to Stillwater and Forest Lake, and his record as a pitcher was incredible. And it got better every year as he told the stories. By this year, he was telling us he had only ever lost one game ever. So many of you would come up to me and remind, or come up to him, I should say, and remind him that he had struck out their uncle in 1958 at a town team baseball game on a Sunday. His patented answer was, "Oh, I remember that well. He couldn't hit a curveball." My brother last night reminded me of my dad's stories of barnstorming days around the state with a basketball team he put together and played all over Minnesota, making $25 a game with his old Gopher buddies. We are happy to share our dad with the people of Fergus Falls, and it's particularly Milt Osnes. Milt worked at Minnesota Motors in Fergus. They met at a wild game dinner that my dad spoke at. It began a friendship that found those two hunting all over South Dakota, Minnesota, and in Gordon, Wisconsin. He loved to travel to North Dakota. His good friends Mark and Penny hosted him many times over the past years. I once asked him how he tolerated that long drive across North Dakota. And he would look at me and say, "What would I be doing instead?" This is his common sense. "I'd be watching TV." He stated he'd see more things of interest driving across North Dakota than he would ever see sitting in his chair at home. The birds and wildlife were of much more interest to him than anything on TV. The song of the meadowlark interested him more than anything he could see sitting at home. Dennis Anderson was able to chronicle many of his many trips of my dad. His writings in the Star Tribune were well-written accounts of my dad's love for hunting and fishing. I think Dennis really understood my dad and was able to share that with readers. My dad loved Iowa. Numerous hunting trips included heading to Coon Rapids, Iowa, and hunting with Wally Hilgenberg and his family. Along with Roy Winston and Lonnie Warwick, Iowa is also the place where my dad met and began his relationship with the great coach and friend Jerry Burns. We truly did share our dad with the people of Northwest Wisconsin. Gordon, Wisconsin, in that area was his playground for over 80 years. It's hard to imagine a Super Bowl coach of today relishing in driving around jackpine country on sand roads looking for a crow to hunt or looking to see where a badger might have been digging a hole. We shared our dad with Bunk and Eddie and Ron and Fred and Les, and many of them are here today. To them, he was a good friend who knew where they planted the trout on Ox Creek or knew where the good blueberry patches were. And then he would kindly ask him if he'd go get some for him and bring them back in a coffee can. We shared our dad with the great people of Winnipeg. We were there for 10 years. Sam Diamond took my dad under his wing, and my mom and dad loved the people of Winnipeg. This is where his long-lasting relationship with assistant coach John Michaels began. Our families and the Michaels became great friends, and we all fondly remember all of us growing up on 306 Laidlaw in Tuxedo, a then prairie suburb of Winnipeg. And certainly my dad was a man of the Twin Cities. He lived in Bloomington for 56 years in the same home. People would see him out and about, and he was happy to visit. They saw him as one of their own. He would sit and talk to people at his garage sales, and people felt he was just a common man. Bloomington is where he and his wife, Pat, raised six children who are now 30-some grandchildren. My dad could never get the number right, and I'm not sure I could, with his grandchildren and great-grandchildren. His legacy for the Upper Midwest will live through all of us. In his later years, his greatest joy came when we would all gather around him at the lake or at the home, and he was no longer the great stone face. Dad loved being a representative of the Upper Midwest, especially Minnesota. I know you loved him, as we did. If he was here, he would stand here and say he wants to thank you for not smoking. Thank you.
Thanks so much, Mike. Stories that go on and on and on, and we'll hear a lot more as the afternoon goes on. Now it's time to talk a little more about the football teams that Bud coached and the players that he cared so deeply for. So let's hear from two guys near and dear to Bud, who I'm certain would have loved to have been here today. I know one of them, the captain, that's all I have to call him, is watching from home today. Nevertheless, have some heartfelt thoughts on their head coach. That, of course, is the captain, Jim Marshall, and Hall of Fame quarterback, Fran Tarkenton.
In all my life, I've never had a coach like him. He never raised his voice to me or any of our teammates, but he knew how to lead. Every player in the locker room could feel it and followed. For more than 50 years, whenever someone asks me, what's it like to play for Bud? I've told them the same thing. If you can't play for Bud Grant, you can't play. A few years back, he wrote a book and called it, I Did It My Way. That is the perfect title for him. He was the most genuine, authentic person I've ever known. He wasn't trying to be Lombardi or Landry or Shula or anybody else. He was just himself, and his way was usually the exact right way. Bud will never leave my life. I will draw on all the lessons and stories and ideas that he shared with me forever. When we talked, everything he said made sense. He taught me more than anyone else in my life how to make things work. He not only made me a better player, but he made me a better person. That's true not only for me, but for all of us who knew him, and there will never be another person like Bud Grant. He'll always be my mentor, my coach, my hero. Rest in peace, my friend. I love you.
Bud Grant was wise beyond years. It was always a pleasure to talk to Bud about all kinds of situations because he had an answer for everything. And if he didn't have the answer, he'd make you think he had the answer. And that's the type of guy he was. He's a great communicator. An ability to talk to his people. And they would know exactly what he means. He had his own language. He had his own way of pointing. If he wanted you to do something and it was time to get it done, he might just give you a signal over there, you know, never say a word. And everybody looked to him for, what do we do? What do we do next? Bud Grant will be remembered as the greatest football coach that Minnesota had. And like I said, I've had a lot of great coaches. But Bud's number one in my book. To the whole family, Pat, sorry for your loss, for the family's loss. But we'll all carry something away from Bud. You as a family, and me as a player. I love you, Bud. We'll all miss you.
Bud Grant always referred to Jim Marshall as his bell cow. He came up with that phrase because he knew the other players would follow what Jim said, and he made him one of his favorite Viking perhaps of all time, and we wish Jim well, is for sure. Well, moving tributes, as you just heard, from two Viking legends about their head coach, Bud Grant. And as Bud has stated, to coach the Minnesota Vikings is an honor and a privilege. Throughout the illustrious history of this team, going back to 1961, there have only been 10 head coaches, all aspiring to the legend of Bud Grant, including current head coach Kevin O'Connell.
Here's the coach. Pleasure is all mine.
It's like numbers.
Kevin O'Connell. Nice to meet you. Thank you guys so much for coming today. Big day. I saw your office upstairs. I hope to see you in it.
Hey.
Hi, guys. These are my kiddos. This is Quinn. Give high fives. This is Coach Bud Grant. Ah, greatest coach in Vikings history.
Yeah,
I'm 36, but
I gotta get out of
sometimes I feel like I'm 70 now. I just want to keep it, that's all. I don't care what color it is.
The facilities, the stadium, the incredible history of the Vikings organization. I mean, I had such strong feelings of the Wolf family, you know, just from afar, you know, looking at the type of commitment they've made to trying to build a winner.
Did you meet Coach Grant?
I did. He met my whole family.
He gave you a thumbs up.
Yes.
It's my pleasure to introduce the current head coach of the Minnesota Vikings, Kevin O'Connell. Kevin, thank you so much for being here today.
Yeah, it's really, really special for me to be here today. And, you know, I hadn't seen some of those clips. I have a freeze frame picture of that when Bud met my three kids at the time, right in my office. I see it every day, but I hadn't seen that video. And that was really, really special for me. And just so thankful to the Grant family and everybody for allowing me to be a part of this today. Because although I didn't know Bud personally long, it was maybe one of the more impactful relationships that I've had over the past year since being blessed to become the head coach of the Minnesota Vikings. And I don't take that for granted one day, and my interactions with him absolutely meant the world to me.
We should mention, Kevin, that both at Winter Park and now at TCO, Bud maintained his office.
Yep.
And you know, a lot of paraphernalia in there, a lot of hunting items as well. But you made it a weekly, it wasn't like you just met him and said hello to him in the cafeteria. You made it a point to almost have a weekly visit with Bud. What were those meetings like for you personally in the course even of this past year?
Yeah, it actually started at that first interaction at my press conference. I said, I hope to see you a lot at the building more and more. And he said, I'll be here. And I said, okay, well, what does that look like? And Bob Hagan started organizing a weekly lunch hour, no matter what the season was like, no matter how busy that I might have seemed at times. If Bud was going to make the effort to come to our facility in Eagan, I was going to be there. So lucky and fortunate to just get wisdom throughout the year. It might have been when my daughter was born And just hearing him speak about how much his family meant to him and how to always have that work-life balance, because there's nothing more important in our lives than our family. Or when we, you know, we're winning a few games in a row, he kept on telling me, have a short memory. Short memory, because on this very field, when it didn't go our way, even in the slightest against the Dallas Cowboys, what do you think he said to me after that game? Short memory. So the wisdom, and there's time and time again, I think back to some of the conversations, even all the way up to the very last one, the week we played the Giants in the playoffs. There was just wisdom there. Never overbearing, always authentic, always real from a standpoint of genuinely caring about you know, me, my family, and knowing what it was like times a thousand to be the head coach of the Minnesota Vikings. His willingness to share anything with me was such a blessing for me, and I'm so thankful to him for doing that weekly. And, you know, I'm going to quite honestly miss that more than anything in year two.
Well, as you mentioned, Kevin, as a father of four young kids, you look at Bud and you see those old pictures of his family being raised in the context of him being a coach and having his priorities in order. Easier said than done in this kind of meat grinder of a world you live in where there's so much pressure day in, day out. So what did you learn from Bud in terms of kind of keeping that steadiness to your lifestyle?
Well, first and foremost, he always made fun of me because he thought, I can't believe you have 22 coaches on your staff.
He had four.
He said, I had four, and those four guys were hard enough to manage, so I have no idea how you manage 22 guys and still get home to your family, still be there for your kids, be there for your wife. And, you know, he never let me hear the end of that. You know, what do you – I mean, you're not busy. You got 22 coaches. There's only so much work to do. But no, he always made it a point to ask about my family, how genuinely excited. He asked about – you know, my oldest, what's he doing? Is he playing Little League? Is he, you know, is he playing flag football? He wanted to know about Caden. And then all the way down to my daughter Callie being born during the season. That next week, Pat and Coach showed up, and they had a little stuffed animal duck. And he said, I want you to give this to your daughter. And literally this morning when I went to get her out of her bed this morning, she was squeezing onto that duck in her, you know, in her crib. And it just made me think of Bud, and I told my wife just how special today was going to be for all of us. So,
Kevin, from a football standpoint, spanning the generations, are there lessons to be had and to learn from Bud and the way he approached the game itself, the X's and O's, even though the game has, of course, dramatically changed, or has it, to that point that you could still learn and glean things from Bud?
Absolutely. I think hearing Fran and Jim talk about the type of coach he was, authentic, genuine, you know, unbelievable leadership characteristics that transcend time. I'm still on that hunger for learning about people like Bud, because they lead the right way. Mm-hmm. They care about the people that they're leading. And in the end, they never make it more important than the things that are most important in life, which is family, which is relationships, which is years and years and years from now. You know, when Fran Tarkenton's grandkids talk about his relationship with Bud Grant, they're going to still say, you know, he never yell and scream, but he always was the best leader that they've ever been around. And if you couldn't play for Bud Grant, you couldn't play. I like to pride myself on trying to attempt to have that sort of authenticity, that sort of humility every day leading an organization like Bud Grant did at the highest of levels for so long.
Kevin, thank you so much for sharing your insights and your stories with Bud. I'm sure it'll be unforgettable, and he'll carry him in your heart for the rest of your life. Thanks so much, Kevin.
Yeah, thank you guys for letting me be a part of today.
Yeah. Of course, you have the benefit of playing in this beautiful stadium. Bud, as we know, made his mark playing at Mets Stadium, and throughout the great runs of his teams in the late 60s and throughout the cold weather games of the 70s, especially at Mets Stadium. People remember, they were synonymous with the Vikings. Those of us here in the bold north know that Bud was the driving force behind his teams, not only be overcoming it, but in his words, embracing the cold.
We've got a kind of a forgotten reputation now. You got to be ready to play in any kind of weather.
We got the right name, we're the Vikings, so let's be a cold weather team. And we're going to be cold because we're going to practice in the cold. You're going to get used to the cold, and you can catch and kick and hold a football in the cold weather. Look what the other team is doing. I got heaters over there. Where are the players? They're huddled around those heaters. They're not even watching the game. They're trying to get warm. I said, we'll alleviate that because we won't have heaters. You watch the game. You be ready to go in. You be ready to play. Let them have their heaters. They got to buy into it. They got to buy into the team concept. None of them are worth their salt by themselves, but together they were great.
I can't say that anybody enjoyed it, but we embraced the weather as part of our culture.
Oh, what memories of Met Stadium, for sure. Now joining us, someone who grew up here in the cold and knew Bud from the time she was very young. I remember very well as the daughter of legendary sports writer Jim Klobuchar. We are pleased to be joined by Minnesota Senator Amy Klobuchar. Senator, thank you so much
thank
for being
you,
here.
Mark. Thank when you, Mark. Thank you. What an incredible, incredible celebration.
When you look at that video of Met Stadium and think of you growing up and knowing your dad was covering this team on a weekly, daily basis, what memories flash for you?
Okay, honestly, I hadn't planned to say this, but the memory when I watched that was I once went with my best friend from high school. My dad got tickets. My dad was in the press box, and it was 20 below zero wind chill or some crazy thing, and we were so cold, and we just started following at halftime two guys in snowmobile suits so we could stand next to them because they were warm, and all of a sudden we found ourselves in the men's bathroom. That happened. Okay, now let me get a little more serious about Bud for the sake of this incredible family with Lori and Kathy and Pete and Dan and Mike. What a beautiful job. And following Coach, thank you. Thank you, Coach, and the team, by the way, for giving me the best moment of my life to troll the Indiana Senators after that Colts game and the biggest comeback in NFL history. So my earliest memories of Bud is that my dad and Sid, by the way, they were covering, of course, Van Brocklin. My dad would get into huge fights with Bud's predecessor, Norm Van Brocklin. And as a little kid, I would hear him on the phone swearing at each other. One time they got in a fist fight in a bar. But then comes Bud, and he is so stoic. He is so incredible. And he would call our house, and I would answer at age 7, Klobuchar residence, Amy speaking, and then there would be silence. And I would say, hello, hello? And Bud would just say, Jim. And after about 3 times, I learned the drill so that when he would call and there would be silence, I would just run to get my dad.
Yeah, yeah.
And that was Bud, because he wasn't going to waste any words, and he sure wasn't going to get into fights about the game. He was just doing his job and following up with the reporter. And I think you just see this in how he handled the team and his players.
But as a little girl, you had a kind of really a ringside seat to, I mean, without even knowing it, to a legacy that was just in its early stages because your dad covered this team. I couldn't wait to get home on a Monday and read your dad's column in the Star, Minneapolis Star. There used to be an afternoon paper here, by the way, and I used to read his column because they were just glorious to read.
Well, I think also for my dad covering those games and seeing Bud win, what was it? The number of games, over 150, took us to the Super Bowl 4 times, of course, leading my dad to then write the book, which is sadly still relevant today, Coach, in 1976, called Will the Vikings Ever Win the Super Bowl? But in any case, Bud was just such a part of that. And what was great, speaking of losing or winning, is that win or lose, he would have his cool. He would keep his cool.
Mm-hmm.
And it didn't mean he would talk to the players about things that had to be done differently. But it was that image and that leadership that the coach was talking about that I think transcended football, right? It was about our state.
Yeah.
And that cold weather and the fact that he went out there at that Seattle game, right, when he was 88 years old in below zero temperatures in shirt sleeves to flip the coin.
What a
he
moment.
He kept that up to the end.
Senator, thank you so much. I know you have something to present to Mike Grant and the Grant family today as well.
Well, I sure do. So this is something, Mike, from the United States Senate. And I will say that in the Senate right now, we're not agreeing on much. But we did agree that Bud Grant is a hero not only for Minnesota, but for our nation. And so this is something that passed through the United States Senate, honoring Bud for his incredible leadership.
Well, thank you so much. And my dad would have looked at this and said, how much can I get for at the garage sale for it if he signed it? But we do appreciate it. We appreciate, again, the love everyone had for my dad.
I have a feeling that it might get less than the Vikings horns, but I'll try my best.
Thank you.
Thanks, Senator. Thanks, Mike. That would be a hot item at the garage sale, no doubt about that. Well, as we know, Bud was a legend. We use that word, kind of being overused at times, but in Bud's case, it certainly fit. Not to just us in these parts, but throughout the entire National Football League, spanning the decades. And to put that in perspective, current NFL Commissioner Roger Goodell.
Bud Grant was an NFL legend whose name instantly made you think of the Minnesota Vikings. He was a formidable athlete, a first-round draft pick of the Philadelphia Eagles in 1950, who was the only man to play in the NBA and the NFL. And of course, he was a formidable coach, whose teams made the playoffs 20 out of his 28 seasons as a CFL and NFL coach. He took his CFL teams to 6 Grey Cups, led the Vikings to 4 Super Bowls, and remains the winningest coach in Vikings history. And you had to admire his no-nonsense, practical approach to the game. During his time, the Vikings were always the last team to report for training camp. Why? It wasn't going to make our team better, he said. Cold weather games? Don't look for heaters on the field or players wearing gloves or long sleeves with Bud Grant. True to form, when he was 88 years old, and was asked to take part in the coin toss for the Vikings playoff game against the Seahawks in 2016, in minus 6 degree temperature, he asked me to hold his jacket when he went to the midfield in his short sleeve golf shirt. He certainly loved the Vikings and defined them for more than 50 plus years as a coach and administrator. But he also defined the state of Minnesota. He was an avid outdoorsman, a man of his community whose annual garage sale was marked on every neighbor's calendar. And above all, he loved his players. I spoke to him on his 95th birthday. While he appreciated the call, and after a few pleasantries, it was clear he had something on his mind that he wanted to discuss: Jim Marshall and the Hall of Fame. Bud was Bud until the end, and we are all better for having known him.
And that's where Jim Marshall absolutely belongs, in Canton, Ohio. Now, as Commissioner Goodell so eloquently said, we're all better off having known Bud. I still, much to the chagrin of my daughter, many times use some of the lessons I learned from Bud. In particular, I use the phrase, never make a decision before you have to, and I tell my daughter that until she rolls her eyes at me and goes, Dad, I know you're going to quote Bud again, aren't you? I went, well, it's common sense, isn't it? It is. We're joined on stage here by three gentlemen who knew him very, very well, legendary player and coach Paul Wiggin, as well as someone who spent countless outdoors hunting and fishing with him, Ron Scherer, of course, is synonymous with that in the state of Minnesota. And rejoining us, of course, Mike Grant as well. Let's start with you, Paul. There's so many stories I'm sure you could say, but when did you first encounter Bud, and what point did you guys become friends and cohorts?
Well, actually, it was when I really came to interview. We had crossed paths a little bit at different times, but the first time for me was when I came to interview. And I was really prepared. I mean, I read and did everything to make a great impression because I wanted to be with that staff. And I ended up asking me about the salmon in the San Francisco Bay and if I'd ever fished there. And And when he got through the interview, never much came from me. He finally said, you know, Paul, I've talked to two or three people. They said that you would be a good hire, so I'm going to give you the job. And I said, wow, I was riding high. That's what I wanted to do. He said, but you got to go down and see a guy named Mike Lynn about getting your contract. And I said, okay. And I got up, and as I started to walk out the door, he said, Paul, before you go, do you know that I don't speak Spanish, but I understand Spanish? And I said, he said, do you understand what I'm saying to you? And I was on a roll, you know, so I said, yeah, I do. And I go out in the hall, and I had no idea what the hell he was talking about. And so I thought about it before I went down to see Mike Lynn, and what he was saying to me is, I don't know how to make a great coach on the defensive line, but I know what one is. So, Paul, I'm hiring you to be that. And he just had a way of doing that. He was one of the most unique human beings. And I said, this is a football coach. This guy, I thought I was sitting with some ancient philosopher or something, you know.
Felt that way.
He was, to me, a tremendous influence in my life. Unfortunately, it came at a later date. I wish I'd have met him and had that opportunity when I was a young guy. But he was magical to us. And the thing I remember most of all, the command factor. Well, you know, this was these players that you see up here were great, great players, and they were fun-loving players, and they'd be in laughing and having fun in the meeting room, and in would walk Bud, and all of a sudden, dead silence, and the faces turned, focused completely on Bud Grant. I said, "Wow, that is command," and he had it, but he to me was a powerful influence in my life. Just his family ways, you know. Everybody, he sounds like they're just saying that. That's not true. He was a true, true family man, and his perspective on football. My wife would tell you that if I could just not think football all the time, our marriage would be a lot better. He had the ability to blend things in a very good way, and so that's my two cents. I met one of the most influential guys in my life in that first encounter. He was some
great stories, Paul. Ron Scherer, you have a different perspective about Bud, having spent many a time in a duck blind or shooting pheasants and just away from football, away from the game. But that was maybe his real true passion as well. So. What can you tell us behind the curtain a little bit about Bud and what it was like to spend all that time with him?
Well, when I was 1968, I started writing an outdoor column for the Minneapolis Tribune. I didn't know it then, but Bud Grant was probably my longest reader, you know. Mm-hmm. Not to insult the sports reporters, but I think he probably read my stuff before any Viking game. But I became addicted to wild turkey hunting in the Black Hills of South Dakota when I worked for the Game and Fish out there. Minnesota did not have turkey hunting at that time, but I would write about turkey hunting. So Bud said to me one day he'd like to try that. So we put together a trip. We flew out to Rapid City together, and that was his very first turkey hunt. And I found the best guide I could for him. They went one way, and I went another, and we hunted 2 or 3 days, and I got a turkey, and Bud didn't. It was a long ride back to the airport. But I'm fond of that because he became addicted to turkey hunting. After that, he would go to Kansas, Minnesota, other places to chase wild turkeys, which is a very addictive thing. One of my fondest memories of our time together, we hunted quail in Iowa. We hunted pheasants in North Dakota. We hunted ducks in Canada many, many times. But one of my fondest memories is I told him one day, I said, you know, Bud, I have a place in northern Anoka County that's loaded with mallards. And I said, you're invited if you want to go. So we picked a Saturday, and it was before a football game, a Saturday, as I mentioned earlier. So he met me in the dark at 6 o'clock in the morning. And we went out to this spot. I have to admit, my blind wasn't very good. There was a jillion mallards there, but they were just skirting us, and we didn't do much shooting. But you know what? With Bud Grant, it didn't matter that much. He was out there among those birds. Mm-hmm. And I said finally one day, Bud, you know what? Most of the Minnesota people right now are very uptight because you're going to play the Cleveland Browns tomorrow in a playoff game.
A championship game.
I said, we're all thinking Bud Grant's probably in his office trying to figure out one more trick play. I'll never forget what he said to me. He said, Ron, if I don't have it figured out by now, I never will. That's my fondest memory.
Yeah, that sums it up. And Mike, we've talked so much about your dad in so many different ways, family, dinners, everything else. But as such a successful head coach yourself at the high school level, you know, growing up in that shadow, always having the Grant name associated with your, you know, at Eden Prairie, winning 11 state championships, you know, was it difficult to kind of navigate that at first, kind of creating your own image, your own like, your own stamp of what you wanted to be as a head coach?
Well, it was, but all of my brother and sisters dealt with that. You were Bud Grant's son or Bud Grant's daughter.
Right.
That's who you were. That was always the added. This is Mike Grant, Bud Grant's son. And what I found really interesting for Amy Klobuchar, I heard her introduce somebody. She goes, this is Amy, Jim Klobuchar's daughter today. And I'm thinking, oh, she hasn't made enough of a mark as a U.S. senator, right, that she's introduced first as Amy, a United States senator. She's still, to this day, Jim Klobuchar's daughter. And so we certainly are proud to be that, to be his sons and daughters. So, you know, there were maybe things that were inconvenient, but when you get a chance, you know, with Carl Eller is here and Jeff Wright and those guys, when you get a chance, and we were ball boys, to pick up their dirty jocks and wet towels, those are great opportunities we had as kids, that you got to kind of weigh it, you know, like, is it
pluses and minuses
pluses
there.
Pluses and minuses to the whole thing. But one of the, I just wanted to say that, make sure that I had a chance to say that, you know, my dad's best friend in his life was Sid Hartman. And Sid Hartman would have loved to have been here. Now, he would have been walking around with his, you know, with his tape recorder.
Let me tell you something, Mike. I can tell you exactly what he would have been doing. You
know, what was that?
Exactly that.
He would have been looking for a story, right?
Yeah, exactly.
But he would have been here. And we remember, my family remembers, we play at noon in a big game against the Packers. My mom would have dinner on the table at 6 o'clock. Sid would be there, sometimes Chad, and Sid would be there. We would be eating her goulash that she made, and Sid would want to talk about the game. And my dad would say, we don't talk about football at the table. Mm-hmm. Now, if you want to talk about hunting or whatever, that's fine. But I have no memory of him ever coming home after a game and talking about the game, and it killed Sid because he wanted the scoop or whatever.
Yeah, that would be. They were the odd couple. We're going to talk to Chad a little bit later about that whole relationship because I had the honor of being in Canton in 1994 when Sid was inducted, and of course when Sid was inducted, it felt like Sid was inducted when Bud was inducted, but Sid had the honor of introducing him, which was really amazing to think about that relationship they had. But the takeaway for this and the legacy as we look around here and. And we're going to keep celebrating Bud's life as the season goes on. Paul, I'll start with you just real quickly. One other just kind of takeaway from your relationship with Bud and what you're going to carry on for the rest of your life.
Well, I think what it would be, it was the fact that he wasn't the prototypical coach. He did things his own way. Give a good example. On the first day of a training camp there, there are five of or six of us sitting around in his room, and he turns to Pete Carroll, our defensive backfield coach, and he said, you know, Pete, I want you to go to the library and learn about the Kuiper Pass. And I never heard of the Kuiper Pass. My wife said, she said, you should, Paul. You should know that, but I don't know it. But anyhow, but instead of talking about something important in football, he was talking about him going to the library in Mankato, getting a speech to come and prepare to present to the staff on Friday. On Friday of that week, we sat, and here's Pete Carroll, who's like a 8-year-old second grader or something, standing up in front of us, presenting the Kuiper Pass and we're sitting there listening to it, and that was the end of it. And I never knew why he did it, but it didn't make sense to me. But it was the Bud's way of doing things.
That reminds me of being down. You're covering another training camp practice in Mankato, and Bud would be wandering from field to field. And he'd come up to me, and he'd go, there'd be a monarch butterfly that would fly over my head. And he goes, do you know where that monarch butterfly is heading? I went, I don't know, St. Peter? He goes, no, Mexico. And he would go into great detail about, right, Ron? I mean, about the migration of the monarch butterfly while practice was going on. But that was Bud.
It really was, Bud. Yes, what was special? You know, he was pretty famous way back then, when he was a hunting and fishing partner of mine. But what struck me is when I got into television, Minnesota Bound, we went to his cabin, and he wanted to show me his antler collection. He would collect them like crazy. And we opened his garage door, and on the floor there was antlers all over. And he could almost say exactly where each one he had found. But he was still Bud Grant, famous football coach. But when we were together like that, he was just one of the boys. He loved to just talk hunting. So that's what was so special to me.
And Mike, finally, were you aware of how much stuff Bud had in his house for those garage sales? It seemed like he would never run out of things, and he didn't.
Well, later in the years, he had some contributors that would contribute.
Okay.
And my dad was more than happy to sign, and many of you may remember, the sign for $25. He'd sign whatever you bought. And so he was happy to do that. You would think, I know my family and I, as we've been going through his house in Bloomington, a couple times have asked, did he sell anything at the garage sale? Because he still had all this stuff, you know. You know, the one story I'll tell real quick about Pete Carroll again. Pete was a young coach that came to the Vikings, and Pete told me this story. He said, all you Viking fans will appreciate this. So they're at Winter Park early on, and Pete said, I got there an hour and a half early. You know, we're going to go on the field for a spring practice for whatever they called it back then. And he said, I was sitting there, no one's there, and where is everybody? We're getting a half an hour or 40 minutes from practice. And finally, Jerry Burns walked in, and you know, Jerry goes, hey, boy, what do you got? You know, and he had no idea what Jerry Burns said.
None of us ever did.
Yeah. So Jerry was talking to him, and he didn't know what Jerry said, because he was asking him, like, well, what's the practice plan? What's the practice plan? And Jerry goes, well, we're going to get out of here. So anyway, my dad walks in 15 minutes before practice and says, and Pete, you know, Pete is sitting there eager in his new stuff. He's ready to go. And he said, Bud, what's the plan? What's the plan to, you know, the practice plan? And my dad looked at him and said, I hired you to coach defensive backs. Go coach the defensive backs. That's all he had.
It worked.
And there was some wisdom in that, because Pete's done fairly well.
Yeah, he's still going pretty well
now. Yeah, he's doing pretty
71.
Good.
Mike Grant, Ron Scherer, Paul Wiggin, thank you so much for your stories and your insight into the legendary Bud Grant. We were talking, Mike, as well. You, like any coach, dealing with the media was part of your job. You had to do it on a daily, Kevin knows that, a weekly basis. But Bud had what could be described as a non-traditional relationship with one particular media member. Yeah, you know who it is, the one and only Sid Hartman.
First time I met Sid was, we were playing, I was at the Great Lakes, and playing on the basketball team. The Great Lake basketball team played the University of Minnesota. He comes in the locker room and said, are you going to come to Minnesota?
He didn't say, I'm Sid Hartman, I'm just, who's this guy? You know, and I said, well, I don't know. He said, well, I said, I don't know where I'm going to go to school yet. I'm not out of the service yet. That was my first introduction to Sid Hartman. He was my best friend.
And at Grant's induction to the Pro Football Hall of Fame in 1994, it was Hartman who presented his closest personal friend for enshrinement.
He said, okay, you say, who's going to introduce you? You know, which is his, you know, that's his job. I says, you are. And he looked at me the longest time and says, really? He said that, he mentioned later that's the greatest honor he's ever had. And he would be induct me into the Hall of Fame. And we hugged and, you know, that was it.
As all of you know, working journalists are taught to avoid friendships with the people they cover. They call it conflict of interest. If that had been the rule some 45 years ago, it would have cost me one of the best friends I have on this earth.
And there's that Hall of Fame jacket that belongs to Bud Grant in the bust. To get a media perspective, I'm looking forward to this conversation from left to right. We got my former colleague at Channel 4, Mike Max, a guy named Chad Hartman, Patrick Ricey, who covered the Vikings for many, many, many years, going back to Bud, going back to Van Brocklin, I think, wasn't it? Just about.
I never got him.
No. And Dan Barrero, of course, from KFAN as well. Chad, let's just start with you because it is, people still are baffled about the relationship, but it was so real. And so, you'd never find two people that were more similar than your dad and Bud Grant, yet they remained the closest of friends till the end, till Sid's passing and, of course, what just recently.
For sure. I mean, these three gentlemen with me knew my father and Bud extraordinarily well. And I remember one of the first times Bud ever told me this story, and Mike alluded to it before, that almost after every Viking game, my father would go there. And Mike nailed it. My father wanted to break everything down, and Bud did not want to talk about it. And so one time, I'm an early teenager, and all of a sudden, it's just me and Bud sitting at the table together. And Bud was so quiet at the time, I'm thinking, what are we going to talk about? And Bud looks at me and says, do you know why I became friends with your father? And I'm thinking, wow, this is going to be really, I'm going to learn a lot about this. And he says, your father had a car.
There was always an angle.
And I said, anything else? And he goes, no, not at the time. It was nothing else. He just said a car. But they became inseparable. They became, and they had nothing in common outside of the Vikings. You know, I see that moment at the Hall of Fame. You know, my father drove over to my house and told me about that and was in tears. My father hardly ever was in tears. And so he said, at the end, I'll show this to you. And so the first time he showed me a copy of it, I got to tell you, about 85% of it was all about him. And I said, we probably need a little bit more about Bud in this speech. You know, it can't be about. But I thought he nailed it. And I just, you know, being around those two gentlemen a lot late, it stunned me so much how emotional Bud would get about that relationship and how much it mattered to him. And almost every single time, he was in tears. And, you know, my father passed away. It was during the pandemic. And part of the Jewish tradition is at the end you go to the cemetery and you take the shovel and you put a little bit of dirt. And Bud was struggling to get up. But as Bud would say to his family, and buddy, if you're determined, you can do anything.
Right.
And he struggled to get out of the car and tears in his eyes, and he put that shovel down. And he grabbed the dirt and put it in there, and then he whispered to me, your father, we'd be proud of you.
Yeah.
And it was one of the biggest moments for me. Two were inseparable.
Goosebumps listening to that story. Patrick Ricey, you have, speaking of stories, tons of them covering the old Trapper. And I always wondered when I saw out-of-town writers come into town, you know, to cover a big game with Bud, how they'd have, like, be a deer in headlights. They didn't know what hit them. many times when Bud would be trying to answer these questions or what to make of them. But your relationship, how would you describe your relationship with Bud?
I actually got to know him much better the last 7, 8, 10 years. I never, you know, during the glory years I was covering baseball. But we had some great conversations the last few years. Here's my thought today, though. As I was walking into this place, down the steps into this cathedral for football, and I recall being out at Met Stadium, and they're getting ready to play a playoff game, and they have a tarp rolled back 30 yards so they can practice. And the punter's down there in the snow, punting into other snow. And to think how that great team was formed in these incredibly low-scale, low-rent conditions. You know, the famous story is George Allen brought his team here for that first playoff game with the Rams to practice in the cold. Bud took his team to Tulsa and came back.
I was
back
there.
And,
I remember that.
Came back. And
it was cold there, too.
Yeah, it was cold there, but at least it was warmer than here. But poor George Allen was going to outfox Bud. And this stuff today that he said about adopting the cold weather was just fantastic, I thought. And I got to say this about Bud, and it sounds a little egotistical, but he's a great PR guy. In his own soft way, right? And for 30 years, he told me, Sid's a reporter. The rest of you guys are just a bunch of writers. He's a reporter. He goes out and finds a story. Yeah. For the last 5, 6 years, he says, you know what I like about you? You're a writer. You're not just a reporter. So Sid wasn't around anymore. He turned that around on him. So, he was still an extremely interesting guy. A couple of weeks before his death, we had a big talk, and he was telling me, I got stories I've never told people. We're going to have lunch someday. You know, it never happened, but I'd love to hear those stories.
Dan Barrero, you had Bud on a couple times as a special guest on your show, and it was captivating radio and sharp as ever up until the end. And what were your takeaways from Bud? Because I know you weren't here when he was coaching, but it's just astonishing his recollection of detail. That's the one thing I got out of it as much as everything else.
The last time we had him on, I think it was his last long interview before he passed away, what struck me is physically he looked a little diminished. You know, he was stooped over more. He was having difficulty moving. And I was almost apprehensive. And
was still so sharp. He was so precise. He looked right at me. Every question I asked, he answered directly, including he even talked, I don't even know how the subject came up, about whether he believed in God or not, which everybody else around was all, oh my God, now he's going to, what's going to happen to Bud here? But that's Bud. Bud didn't care. And his, like you say, the fact that he remained so sharp even towards the very end is what always impressed me. You know, the context for me is different than so the rest of you. And I've talked about this on the radio before. And I one of my visions of, one of my biggest memories of Bud is at one of the rummage sales, Justin Gard, my producer, and I are going there to tape an interview with him. And somewhere before we start it, he's in the lawn chair in the driveway talking to people. And I'm looking at some of the stuff, and one of the displays I see is it's travel size soaps that he has saved since his time as a Minneapolis Laker, apparently, and Vikings, etc. And he's going to sell all the soaps. I think the price was $50. There's this huge collection of soaps, and I'm watching this, and I'm talking to him about it. Like, you know, am I going to haggle with Bud? And I'm thinking, what are the odds that a kid 50 years before that grew up in Chicago frightened of Bud Grant? Because he was the coach of the Big Bad Vikings who would always take down the Bears. He looked this remote, basically football god, you know, on the sidelines, never smiled. And here 50 years later, I'm in his driveway haggling with him about how much to pay for his soaps. Life takes some strange turns, Rosie. It really does.
It really does. There's so many stories. And Maxie, our late colleague R.J. Fritz, spent a lot of time with Bud fishing in particular. And I remember R.J. would say, you know, listen, we got to stop at the minnow shop to pick up some minnows that go up there. And Bud goes, what do you mean stop at the minnow shop? They cost like 98 cents a dozen. I have a whole bunch of minnows right here we can catch in my lake. that summed up Bud. But you spent a lot of time with Bud in the outdoors as well.
Yeah, and I grew up, you know, our family got season tickets in 1970 in Met Stadium once a year. The boys got to go. My dad would take one of the boys to the games. You never thought you were going to meet Bud Grant, you know?
Right.
And I remember the first time I finally got enough courage, because I knew him a little bit, to ask him if he wanted to go hunting with me on Saturday. And you know how intimidating, you know, you and I have talked about that. That can be, you know, with Bud. And he says, he pauses, you know, and he says, well, yep. If we're going to go on Saturday, we got to go out and scout on Friday. Pick me up at 6 in the morning here at the office. And we spent the day in the back roads of Minnesota. And Fred Zambrilletti had told me, if you want to hear Bud's best stories, don't ask him about it. Because he doesn't want people that, he doesn't like the, tell me about the, you know, the
right.
Drew Pearson push-off, you
right,
know?
Right,
but he'll open up, and it was one of the greatest days I ever had, and then we formed friendship from that, and we were goose hunting one time, and with Mike and Colleen and Ryan and Taylor and our friend Seaver, mutual friend of both families, they had all gone for some reason, because they had to go different commitments, and Bud and I stayed out there and hunted. We got back to his pickup truck, and I had driven too, and he had lost his keys. Well, Bud Grant doesn't make mistakes like that, right?
No.
And then he didn't have a spare key. So now, Bud Grant doesn't do that, right? I do that. Bud Grant doesn't. So I drive him back to his house, and he goes in. I'm sitting in the driveway, and he cannot find a spare key, so he comes out. And I found out on that very busy Saturday, he called the automobile dealership that where he purchased it, or it was leased or whatever, and he called there, and I found out on that day you cannot get a key made, an original key made, on a busy Saturday unless your name is Bud Grant. And they dropped everything they were doing, and 10 minutes later, there we were. But, you know, we did the speaking circuit together, and we'd go out and we'd speak, and we'd do Q&As and for corporations. And I'd call Bud, and I'd go, they want us to come out and speak again. And there'd always be a pause. And I'd say, this is what they got in the budget. And there'd be another pause, as you know, Mark. And he'd say, cash?
Cash.
Yeah. But the favorite story.
Always cash.
The favorite story that he always told the audience, and they loved him. And you guys know this. You know, when he walked into a room, as you know, everybody gravitated to Bud. He's playing for Winnipeg. They make the All-Star. He makes the All-Star team. He and four of his buddies, they go play in Vancouver. Bud had this theory, as you know well, Mark, I hate to be late and I hate to be early. He's in his hotel room, he calls the airlines, he says, we're booked for a 6 p.m. flight tomorrow night, can we change it to 8 a.m.? They said, well, it's full. He said, well, if it changes, will you call me? Yep. So Bud's theory is, I don't want to go sit on the bus. He waits till the last second to leave the hotel room, phone rings, it's the airline. They said, we can get you and your three teammates on the 8 a.m. flight. Great. Goes down, play the game. Next day, they're all in the lobby at 6 in the morning, including Bob McNamara. And one teammate's not there. He calls him, says, come on down. We'll get you on the plane, blah, blah, blah. Teammate says, no, I was out too late last night. You guys just go. I'll take the 6 p.m. flight. Bud and his teammates get on, fly back to, I think, Minneapolis at 8 a.m. 6 p.m. flight goes off with his buddy, crashes into the mountains. Everybody's killed. Everybody in that plane was killed. And mm-hmm. Bud was supposed to be on that flight.
Oh, he's
and,
told,
yep,
yeah.
And Bob McNamara as well. That's the greatest story I ever heard him tell. And, you know, the way you know how that forms his philosophies in life, you know.
And Chad, yet they both, I mean, Bud, 95, your dad, up to 100. I mean, we all just sort of hopefully avoid those moments. To have them intersect their lives like that. And you, as a someone who is related to really almost both of them, felt that love between them.
Well, they both woke up every day wanting to do something, right? They both had a spirit. They both had a drive. Now, as Mike knows well, my father's spirit at 99 was, I'm going to go to this. I'm going to go to the Vikings. I'm going to go to the Gophers. With Bud, it's, I'm going to find Mike, and we're going to go to the cabin. Or because Mike's told me a lot, and we've talked a lot the last couple weeks about, you know, when he was young, Bud didn't talk to the kids much, never talked to really his friends much. But then all of a sudden later in life, Bud started talking. Mike told me a great story how they would go to this small bar restaurant, you know, not too far from their place. And Bud went in there one morning where nobody recognized him because they were in full hunting regalia. And all of a sudden people started realizing it was Bud Grant. And they gathered around. And if it was a few years before,
Some people might say Bud wanted a part. Bud was listening to their stories, loving their stories. And these people were mesmerized. And I'll just tell one other thing about my father and Bud. One time, about 3-4 years ago, we were out to dinner, and I just would mainly listen, which wasn't easy because I like to talk so much. And these two started talking about how much cash they had hidden in their house just in case they needed it. And Bud goes, well, have you told the family where the money is? Yes, my father goes, no, Chad's not going to know it all. He's just going to have to find it. So my father passed away. I had to grab my oldest son and look around. And then I talked to Mike.
God.
And I said, guess what? Yeah. We had to go find that cash, too. So they had so much in ways that you wouldn't think that just brought them together. And their love was there. Because, you know, my father, I would say the close personal friends, there was never a doubt that Bud was his closest friend, ever.
Pat and Dan, I'll let you guys finish things up with this. We all are acutely aware, and you've written plenty about and talked plenty about Minnesota sports misery, and yet Bud, and it was always true to his convictions. Like the Super Bowl losses haunted a lot of fans a lot more than it haunted Bud, and it was true. He said, it's over with. What can I do about it? Very few people can live their lives that way, that without having those sorts of, not saying he didn't have regrets, but, you know, is there a lesson to be had there? I mean, because he was tantalizing. Well, he was close to it all the time.
Two things. One, I got to bring this up. I forget. The worst question ever asked Bud at the garage sale was a young reporter from, I think, Channel 9. Asking him how much he made on last year's garage sale.
What was his answer? Remember
Bud
that?
Bud said, you from the IRS? And then nothing happened for like 30 seconds. So that one. that would be the other thing is, he was asked a couple of years ago about losing those four Super Bowls, and this wasn't to me, but I heard it secondhand, and I believe it. Bud pointed out that he outlived all four of those guys.
Yeah, so, I can confirm. I can confirm that.
Yeah, he did say that
on air. He did that several times.
He had outlived all four of them. So,
and I could beat him in racquetball. That was the other thing.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, he was. The people never thought Bud was competitive. Oh boy.
Yes.
Everything.
One other thing I was going to mention. You know, I think there's this. The loss. A lot of it had to do with this notion that we know can't be true, but with some people, we tend to believe it, that they're always going to be there. And with Bud, there was that permanence to the point where, not long ago, how long ago was it, we heard the news that Joe Capp had passed away?
Right.
And I heard it in the morning, or I saw it on Twitter, I don't know. And my first thought, because it was a weekday, was, we got to get Bud on.
Yeah.
And then I had that skip, and you go, not there. You know, and so you're so conditioned to believe that this guy's just going to be around forever for all of us as a resource, as someone who, you know, stands for what this team is supposed to be all about and is defined with it. And that's the testament to it. Even after he's gone, I'm still waiting to call him to say, hey, give us some Joe Capp stories, Bud, when you get a chance.
Yeah, I sat right up there in the press box with him, with Pat, last year, the playoff game, and never thought I'd see Bud Grant in the press box, but there he was. It was a moment. We had a lot of personal stuff to talk about. Gentlemen, thanks so much. Dan Barrero, Pat Royce, Chad Hartman, Mike Max, thank you for your insights and stories.
Thanks.
For the fans at home, really enjoyed it. Thanks for coming to be part of this today. Earlier we heard from, of course, a couple of those legends, Fran Tarkenton and Jim Marshall, who gave us touching tributes to Coach Grant. Another player near and dear to Bud, I always call him Ahmad, who allowed me and allowed Ahmad to do a show up against the Bud Grant show before Bud eventually came over and I got the chance to do the show with him. But Ahmad has some thoughts. He wanted to be here in person today. But here's Ahmad Rashad.
Dear friends and family, today we gather to celebrate the life of a remarkable man, our beloved football coach, Bud Grant. Now, he was not only a coach, he was a mentor, a friend to many of us. He was a family man, and he treated his players as if they were his own family. Now, Bud was a huge figure, not only in our city, but also in the state and also in the entire world of sport. Bud Grant was a winner. Now, he dedicated his life to the sport he loved, and his passion for football was infectious. He had an uncanny ability to inspire and motivate his players, me being one of them. He inspired me and brought the best out of me. He also taught us not only how to be better athletes, but also how to be better human beings. Coach believed in hard work, discipline, and respect. He demanded nothing less than our best. He demanded that. Nothing less than our best. But he also knew how to have fun. He used to put duck feet in my shoes, thinking that was very funny because he knew I was afraid of animals. So I guess it depends where you're sitting, how funny that was. But that was our little joke for all those years. I knew he did it, he said he didn't do it, and that's kind of the way it went back and forth. He also was a person that, you know, that knew how to look at people and see the potential that they had in them and then bring it out in them. Coach was a man of integrity. He always led by example. He taught us the importance of sportsmanship and instilled in us a sense of pride and respect for ourselves, our teammates, and also our opponents. We will miss him dearly, but we're grateful for the time we had with him. He will always be remembered for his kindness, his wisdom, and his unwavering commitment to his family, his players, and his community. We celebrate his life, and we're thankful to have been a part of it. Bud Grant is the ultimate Viking.
Thanks, Ahmad Rashad. Now it's my pleasure to introduce four more Viking legends up here on the podium to honor their coach. First off, five-time Pro Bowl running back Chuck Foreman, one of my favorites of all time. Vikings all-time leading tackler, linebacker Scott Studwell, sporting the shorts and the Hoka sneakers today. NFL Hall of Fame defensive end Moose Carl Eller. And one of the greatest 50 Vikings tight end Stu Voigt. Gentlemen, thank you so much. Moose, I'm going to start with you. I think we'll talk about cold, if you can talk about the cold weather. Was cold really a state of mind for Bud, or were you really cold out there at Met Stadium?
Well, we got cold, but Bud says the cold doesn't matter. You know, the guy across from you is the guy you have to play against. And I think the psychology of that really interfered with the other team. So Bud used that to his advantage.
That's true. Scott Studwell, you know all about playing for Bud and what that you went through a lot of transitions with Bud and Les and back to Bud and everything else that happened in between. But what life lessons did you learn from Bud Grant?
You know, it probably didn't sink in until after I was done playing and Bud was done coaching and the relationship that we had wasn't really there, mm-hmm. just because of the player coach relationship. So it really kind of sunk in after we were both done and I was still working for the Vikings in the player personnel department and Bud was still at the office, you know, and you know, he was just, he had such great common sense. And it's something that I think has stuck with me from the minute he first said hello to me to his last breath. He's one of the smartest people I've ever met. The life experiences that he had and being able to transfer that to the people that he surrounded himself with, his family, his players, the front office people, his coaches. You know, he was just, he commanded respect because that's who he was and that's the way he lived and just a fabulous person.
And Stu Voigt, is that a reflection just really how close your teams remain to this day? Because there's a bond there that could never be broken. And I don't know if Bud kind of helped set the table for that, or just the personalities, because you were from all over the country, obviously, but you remained very, very close over all these years.
You know, I hear the terms mentioned today, unique, authentic, a comforter in his own skin. You know, he's one of those guys often imitated but not duplicated. As a coach, it was interesting. Not a backslapper, not a good morning, not a touchy-feely. I often look back at the times, just the look, the Bud Grant look you'd get. If you're in the training room, maybe lobbying Fred Zambrilletti for some easy duty that day, and Bud Grant would walk into that training room, everybody would vanish because, you know, he would say the greatest ability a player can have is durability, and you saw those Viking teams, much like I'm sure Bud was as an athlete, you practice hard, you came to play every Sunday, and you didn't whine about nicks or scrapes or there's injured and hurt, and he had all kinds of jargon, but the fact was this team stuck together. We all liked each other. Leadership, he would lead, but he also passed down the leadership to guys like the great Jim Marshall, Mick Tinglehoff, Grady Alderman, the captains. They'd handle some of the small details. If there was a big behavior problem, Bud would handle that, but his patient, common sense approach and his delegation of duties, whether it be to offense coordinator Jerry Burns or my line coach John Michaels, it all got done, and it seemingly in a seamless manner, which really I think was a kind of a hallmark of these consistent, ready-to-play black and blue Viking teams in the 70s.
Yeah. Chuck Foreman, Bud was not known for playing rookies too often, and you came in this league, we're kind of rookies together, and I remember that year quite well, but were you concerned about that, about getting playing time and trying to convince Bud Grant that you were worthy of some playing time as a rookie on the Vikings?
I was concerned about a lot of things. First of all, my personality, number one. How was that going to work out? Because for me, all right, coming here, I came out of University of Miami of Florida. I really never had one set position there. I was a running back 1 year, then I was a cornerback the next, and I was a wide receiver the next. And so we were at the Senior Bowl, and there was this gentleman just staring at me, you know, this cold as could be, and my friend Wally Chambers came to me and says, "You know who that is?" I said, "No, not right offhand." He said, "That's Bud Grant." So he was sizing me up. But, you know, I don't know if I was uncomfortable, but I was kind of feeling good about it. But then, you know, I went on and I got comfortable playing running back, the running back position, in those All-Star games that I played in, and I was MVP in all of them. And then I get to Minnesota, and I come up here after those All-Star games, and I'm getting ready to line up at what we call the two-back. We had two-back, three-back, two-back being running back, three-back being fullback. And I'm finding myself as a three-back, a fullback. And I'm, like, upset, very upset. So first there was Oscar Reed that came to talk to me. He was, like, the guy that could calm me down. And then I guess it got back to Bud that I wasn't too happy with the fact that he moved me to the fullback position. Unbeknownst to me, the fullback position at the time was the one position that he could pretty much create a different offense to suit my talents. And so he called me in there and he says, "You know, if you come in and do what you're capable of doing, you'll be real special." I'm like, okay. And so, but the Vikings at the time, was they threw the ball to the backs more than anybody in the league. But he said, if I came in and did what I could do, use my abilities, he says, I'd be one of the best, right? And then I was getting ready to get up, and he says, "Oh, and by the way, nobody will recognize it because they only recognize your running stats." Okay, I'm like, well, why are you going to do that? But in his way, he was just way before his time when he could identify talent, see what the talent could do. And so him and Jerry Burns created the position runner-receiver. That's what I played. And then I guess after the second time I was the player of the year, when he came in, I had a separated sternum. And he came in, I was sitting there with Fred Zambrilletti and Dr. Lannon, and they were trying to figure out how I was going to play. Well, Dr. Lannon's idea was he was going to shoot me up with a, you know, with cortisone. The only thing is that needle was that long. And I'm saying, you're not going to put that in me. So they figured out a way to hold the sternum in place. And then Bud had come to see if I was going to play. And then that's like the first time he says, just go be you. Mm-hmm. Okay, runner, receiver, and then there was the Pro magazine right there on the table, and there was a picture of me on the cover, and it said runner, receiver. And that was how it was created. Bud Grant, Jerry Burns.
Yeah, Jerry Burns, another
and that's
great,
like,
man.
Way before his time. And it took him like 50 years to give him recognition for it.
Yeah. You know, right. I want to wind things down with you guys. Just, I'm looking around here on a beautiful day, summer day. A lot of folks showed up here, a lot of people watching at home on television as well. And it's unusual, Stu Voigt, I'll start with you, just in terms of go around the room here a little bit, to have a coach who, you know, a lot of folks weren't even around to watch him when he was done. Because I think he came back in 1985, and that was it. I think he took his bass boat and went home after that again. But to have this association with someone like Bud Grant for all these generations is really unusual. Even in the National Football League, which has had some rather powerful head coaches, as we know, over the years, I can't imagine this happening anywhere else.
Only in Minnesota. And I would say one of the thrills of my life is, of course, I played for Bud, but then you meet Bud on a different arena, played racquetball with him for years.
Yeah, you did.
All his sons were ball boys at Mankato. But then you meet his friends, the Vern Gagne's, the Jim Molaskis, the Billy Byes, the Bob McNamara's, who were peers and probably played on that Rolling Gopher basketball team. What esteem they held Bud in, and what being with them, Bud was a normal, good, humorous guy that everybody loved, and a credit to the state of Minnesota and certainly to the Minnesota Vikings.
And Carl, I'm sure you feel the same way. I mean, that your relationship with Bud over all these years remained extremely special and important to you.
Well, I want to say Bud was the very special person that I think has said a couple of times today. But my relationship with Bud actually grew over the years, more towards the end. I was more of a friend of his, and he would say hi, he would smile. But I was just thinking about Bud. I never really had much communication with Bud in those years that I played for Bud and the years I was with him. And what Bud was concerned about was that how I played and how I did my job. I think that was a great, great connection between me and Bud. You know, so if I played well, that was it. You know, I really didn't have to communicate with Bud, except that he would say something, you know, everything was okay. But if you didn't, if it wasn't okay, he would let you know that. And I think about him in retrospect that Bud was a very sincere person. He wouldn't say something to you that he did not mean. And a lot of times, it would have something to do with you or me as a person rather than him. It was for my benefit. You know, I thought that was very unusual, and because otherwise, I wouldn't say I had a close relationship with Bud, but he would say things to me that was just out of the blue. It was like, you know, you something that would help me as a football player and also as a person. So Bud dearly cared about his players and about the team. He was unusual, a very unusual person. So I have very fond memories of Bud. And, you know, I think of something special about Bud. And I'm not sure, I was thinking about this as I was sitting out in the audience there. And I think that Bud was trying to say, and the last time I saw him, was like, great job, Carl. I think you're really a special guy. You know, I think that's what he's, I really care about you.
Wow.
Yeah. Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you for those words, Carl. Scott, the Will family has done a wonderful job of keeping all you guys together. And I know during the course of the season and next season as well, you have a lot of the legends come back, and the ring, whether it's the Ring of Honor or whatever it is, and it's going to be weird not being up there and not seeing Bud, because I think we always expected him just to be here forever. You know, it just was one of those people that his presence was always felt, even if he wasn't on the field.
You know, I've always felt that way when I heard of Bud's passing. It's the first thing that came to mind was Bud's not supposed to die. Bud's Bud's supposed to live forever, because that's the kind of aura that he had. And maybe it's because he was too cheap to die, but I mean, he just Bud Grant and success are synonymous, and you know, everything that the Vikings have been about, what they're currently all about, is the success that Bud Grant instilled in upper management, players, all the way through to his coaches, this community, Viking fans. I mean, it's all about winning, and it's all about being successful. And, you know, it's unfortunately we haven't brought that big trophy here yet. I think Kevin's going to end up doing that one of these days. But we're, you know, all the people that are behind and coming behind Bud are going to be tugging on his coattails, because he's going to be the first one through the door. And that's the way it should be. That's the way it will be. And that's the way it's always been.
We'll leave it at that. Great words to end with. Scott Studwell, Carl Eller, Stu Voigt, Chuck Foreman. Thank you so much. Thanks for that. Other people. You see, Hub Beads is here. Hub, original mascot for the Vikings. The great Alan Page, Mark Mullaney, Jeff Wright. I'm missing a few as well. But I want to say thanks, everyone, for coming out. What a wonderful day of celebration we've had here to celebrate Bud Grant's life. It's truly been a privilege to be with everyone today. Don't forget, you can also honor Bud by donating to his favorite charities via the QR code Minnesota Veterans Outdoors and the Minnesota Vikings Foundation. We want to thank all of you for being here for such an enjoyable and memorable day. We look forward to continuing to celebrate the legacy of Bud Grant during the upcoming Viking season here at U.S. Bank. Now, as we wrap things up, kind of a surprise as you folks start heading for the exits. Some of you may know this. I saw it firsthand. All you guys know, Bud loved his ice cream. So on your way out, there's an ice cream treat for each of you to exit on this beautiful day as you exit. Yeah. Well, in closing, we want to leave you with one fitting and final message from Bud Grant. In his own words, here's what it meant to be a Minnesota Viking for Bud Grant.
Well, I'm proud of the name, Viking. I mean, it's not like we're a bird or, you know, a reptile or something. We're Vikings, and we're unique, and if I think the Viking name has permeated the whole country. If you mention Viking to anybody, they'll say Minnesota. I'm proud to be a part of Minnesota. I'm proud to be a Viking. I'm proud of the history and, growing up and watching this develop. And so Viking is a name to be proud of, and I'm proud of being a part of the Vikings for all these years. And I think everybody in Minnesota is too.